Hi, I'm RQ. Today, I'll be taking bamboo plywood, acrylic, and a lot of custom electronics and turning it all into a round interactive light sculpture, along with an epic mistake that might have ruined the entire piece. Around a year and a half ago, I decided that 10 years at Google doing low-power wireless networking was enough, and for better or worse, I left my job and decided that I was going to make interactive light sculptures. In that time, I've come up with a process for making these rectangular Voronoi interactive light sculptures using walnut, bamboo, and acrylic. And these are great. I love making them. But ever since I started making interactive light sculptures, I wanted to figure out how to make one that wasn't rectangular. So a few months ago, I made this small test piece to see if I could figure out how to make something curvy, because if I can make it round, I can make it any shape. At least, that was the idea. And I think it turned out nice. It even back projected light onto the wall to try to make the piece feel larger. So with that prototype out of the way, I wanted to scale up this process and make a larger piece using this technique. So I started to brainstorm some ideas. Some of these ideas I really liked and might build later. Others, not so much. But this is the layout that I settled on for this piece. It has a seven-way symmetry that looks really fun and floral while still being a Voronoi diagram. This is the first light sculpture I'm making in my recently renovated barn workshop, so you'll have to forgive all the clutter. Over the next few months, I'll be filling it out with cabinets and wood racks and additional tables, but until then, you'll just have to tolerate the odd cardboard box or toddler wagon. This video is mostly focused on design, fabrication, and assembly, rather than the electronics. I know some of you are very interested in the electronics, especially how hand detection works. If that's something you would like to see me make a video about, please let me know in the comments. So what you've been watching me do here is set up my CNC machine for machining out the first of three layers of bamboo plywood. The first cuts I'm making are for the steel dowels that will be used for alignment later on, like when drilling the screw holes on the back and for the layer glue up. This layer will be the front of the light sculpture. This machine is a Shapeoko 5 Pro, and back when I bought it, I didn't really know how to use it or what the challenges would be using it. I had plenty of experience with building my own 3D printers, but with 3D printers, the concept of work holding is just, does the first layer stick? As a result, I underestimated how tricky work holding could be. Take, for example, this picture of the simulated CNC run. Notice all those pieces inside each cell? If I were to cut them out like this, they would jump out and cause the CNC to crash the moment you cut the first one. So instead, they are held in place with tabs. And these tabs must be removed manually. This is just the first of many tedious and repetitive steps in making this light sculpture. But don't worry, I won't make you watch all of it. Before I do any more machining, I need to paint the insides of the cells white so that they can reflect as much light as possible. As you can tell by the date on this security camera footage, it has been a hot minute since I actually made this piece. It was long enough ago that I actually somehow lost the footage from the camera you see me so carefully moving around, so I had to scrape up the footage from my security cameras for these shots. After the paint dries, the next step is to drill out all of the screw holes in the back of the sheet, which will be used to hold the back plates later. Then it's time to machine out the front. This involves a few steps, cutting out the groove that the diffusers and cover lenses will fit into, as well as performing the V-carve texture in between the cells. This V-carve makes the cells appear like stones embedded in a bamboo grout. It was at this point that I noticed these tiny dimples in the centers of the touch control buttons. A quick pass with an end mill cleared it right up. Now it was time to glue up the first two layers. At this point, I had already machined out the middle layer, which is just a spacer to make sure that the back plates have enough room in the inner cavity. You can see the big notch on the bottom to make room for installing the touch sensor board, as well as the two smaller notches for the ambient light sensor boards. By the way, I do sell these ambient light sensors on my website, so if you'd like to support what I'm doing here, check out the links in the description. I made a silly mistake of using a paper towel to spread the wood glue. This was a terrible idea. Almost immediately, bits of paper towel started to come off and get into the glue, which would prevent a tight surface-to-surface bond. I picked out what I could and kept going. With the first two layers clamped up and drying, I moved on to machining out the last layer. This layer is what the back of the sculpture will attach to. It is also where a channel will be machined that will contain a strip of LEDs to light up the wall around the sculpture, making it appear to float on the wall, and also making the wall itself a part of the light sculpture. At this point, I've already glued the third sheet. What we have now is a big square brick, and I need to use the bandsaw to rough cut the corners off. This bandsaw is beautiful, and it's over 100 years old, and as you can tell by my face shield, feels a bit terrifying to use.
Alright, so this is going to either end horribly, or we'll have a part that's free of the closure. Then, whatever. This part. Take this part off.
To clean up the rough edge from the bandsaw, I'm using a flush cut bit on my table router. The first pass is with the front down, using a cutting bit with the bearing on the bottom. I then swap the bit out with one that has the bearing on the top and start clearing out the rough cut parts toward the back. And this is where things went terribly wrong. The bearing on the flush trim bit yeeted itself into the workshop.
No! I lost my bearing! No!
With the bearing gone, the blades on the router bit cut much deeper than intended, creating a large gouge in the wood that would be very difficult to repair.
Yeah.
So at this point, I'm really upset. I've gotten pretty good at repairing mistakes, but repairing something like this was not something I felt like I could pull off seamlessly. There was no way I was going to sell this piece at this point, but I decided to keep going.
Maybe it sells. I have to hope. That's a lot of work to throw away.
And then something else went wrong.
Ah! Looks like we did get a chip out. And a little bit of delamination. I think I got that.
So here I'm going to go ahead and fix that delamination problem. I'm just masking off some of the wood and then squeezing in some wood glue into that joint and then clamping it together. The small chip turned out to be pretty easy to fix, so I just went ahead and fixed that off camera. Similar to how the inside of the cells were painted white, I'm painting the outer channel white so that it reflects as much light as possible onto the wall.
This gap here, we gotta do something about it. But that's not the only problem. The other problem that I found out when I went to go add the round over was that it's warped. That doesn't look like much, right? But it was enough that when it was laid flat, the round over just dug in on the sides here. It's bent like that. The thing that's gonna, I'm a little scared of is fixing this. And all right, here's my plan. What I'll do, I'm gonna fill this in the same way I filled in the other one. which is I'm going to tape off this area, and then I'm going to add CA glue and sawdust and just build up those layers, and then finish it up with a flush trim bit and sand.
As you can tell, I'm not really satisfied with my plan of action here, but I decided to just go for it.
Well, as they say, all right, time's up. Let's do this. Leroy! So I'm going to use the thick stuff first. I'm going back now. Well, so this basically cures instantly. So it's cure up real fast, almost as if I'd put accelerator on it.
This is why I wear gloves.
Now we can put on this thin CA glue. Yeah, this stuff you gotta be careful with because it's so runny. Alright, I'm left with this kind of ugly blob. It's okay. A few more bits and pieces here. Now, I'm gonna kind of seal the whole thing up with a pass of the CA glue, and then we're gonna shoot the accelerator. We'll hopefully fill in any holes in the top. By the way, I cannot emphasize enough how important it is to wear a mask when doing this. That stuff is gnarly. Clean ourselves up and take a look. All right, so it's gonna look a bit darker, but once the finish goes on, it shouldn't be too bad. Somehow I wasn't recording. There's a little bit of a gap there, but I think I could sand that out. So it looks kind of awful, but once we apply finish to all of this, it shouldn't look as awful.
For my finish, I'm just using Prolux satin wood finish. I know that the cool kids are all using Rubio Monocoat or some other fancy finish, and maybe one day I'll give that a try, but so far I've had good results with this stuff. And in case you were wondering, this is what the patch ended up looking like. It looks pretty awful, but luckily it's on the top, so when it's mounted to the wall, you shouldn't notice it. It's now time to machine out the front cell lenses out of acrylic. In order to do that, we have to have a perfectly flat surface with respect to the cutter, so I'm mounting a new spoil board and leveling it so that I know that it's perfectly flat. I'm leveling it using this 1-inch fly cutter. And now we are back in work holding hell. The best way that I've found to mount acrylic for machining so far is using double-sided tape on a freshly leveled surface. This is totally a pain in the ass, so if you know of a better way, please let me know down in the comments. Sanding the front ahead of time helps reduce the amount of work that I'll need to do later. Preparing the cell lenses is one of the most tedious tasks of building one of my light sculptures. While I did sand the top ahead of time, the round profile needs to be sanded separately in order for it to have the same finish as the top. At first, I started sanding each piece immediately after removing it and taking off all the sticky tape, but I quickly decided that I should just take off all the lenses first and then sand in a separate step. Here I am cutting a small chamfer along the bottom of each lens. This helps reduce the likelihood of damaging the bamboo when inserting the lenses. With all that out of the way, I can now attach the back plates to the frame. These back plates are each entirely unique and need to be placed in the specific location indicated by the number embossed on the back of the plate. I've already inserted the cell board into each back plate off camera. Each back plate is secured to the frame with 3 or 4 wood screws. There are some extra holes in each cell in case one of the holes ever gets stripped out.
All right, it's not quite finished. I don't have all the cover plates on yet, but I did stick the diffusers on it. So now we can get a sense of what it will look like when it's all finished. And it looks pretty nice.
You might be surprised to see me using nail polish here as the glue to glue in the lenses. It turns out that this is the best glue that I tested in terms of ease of use and holding strength. I think it's because it actually dissolves a little bit of the acrylic, helps it seal into the cell. While we are now done with the front of the light sculpture, we still have a few more things to do. Next is installing the edge lighting that will light up the wall around the piece. To do this, I've drilled a small hole into the frame for the wires that I'm now soldering into the LED strip. Then it's just a matter of pulling the wires through the hole and removing the backing from the adhesive to attach the LED strip along the inside wall of the frame. Favorites so far. While I'm not selling this specific piece, I have several other pieces for sale on my website, and I also do custom commissions. If you would like to have one of my light sculptures in your home or office, please reach out. And please like and subscribe, because I know that's kind of cliche, but it really does help.
Time's up. Let's do this. Leroy! Dragons!